Good evening, everyone. This is Apostle Misha Sofdie, and we're presenting our study in the Word this evening. We were supposed to do it yesterday at 8, but unfortunately I couldn't get back from where I was located in time to do this by 8 o'clock, so we moved it over today for Wednesday night, and we'll be back again next Tuesday to continue. So tonight we'll be into part 2 of the question of whether demons can hurt or possess, or whether demons can possess or hurt a Christian. Okay, and this has been a controversial subject for many, because there are many that believe that that a Christian can be demon possessed, and there are many that believe that a Christian can't be demon possessed. Okay, in short, okay, and I want to get into this right now. In short, I don't believe that a Christian can be possessed by the devil. Now, in many churches and places I've been to, among charismatic and Pentecostal circles, but particularly charismatic and Word of Faith circles, people will say, well, we cast out this spirit of lust, or we cast out the spirit of death, or we cast out this spirit or that spirit, when they lay hands on a very legitimate born-again Christian, okay? Can a Christian be possessed by a spirit of lust or a spirit of death or a spirit of this or a spirit of that? I don't believe so. But I think what happens here is that in praying, people make the mistake of not discerning, or maybe not clarifying, the difference between what's called possession, where a spirit actually resides within the person, okay, as opposed to oppression, where the spirit is on the outside harassing a person. Okay, so I don't believe a Christian can be possessed, because I don't think that a true Christian, okay, where the Holy Spirit is dwelling within him, I don't think that a demon wants to dwell in the same place. I don't think it can. And it certainly doesn't want a confrontation with the Spirit of God. So I just don't think you're going to see that. But I believe that a Christian can be oppressed, meaning that there are spirits that can harass a person, a spirit of lust, a spirit of anger, a spirit of death, a spirit of a lot of different things can harass a person from the outside. But we have to understand the difference of possession and the difference of oppression. And then the second question that comes along is when we ask the question, can a Christian be hurt or can a Christian be possessed by a demon? We have to ask ourselves, first of all, who is a Christian? Because there are many people that profess to be a Christian. They may even go to church on Sunday, okay? But their lives, they have a void in their life. They've not totally surrendered. They haven't surrendered their life to Christ in reality. And so you really have to ask that question, because some of us will say, well, I know this person. They went to church. They sang in the choir and did all these things, and a spirit, a demonic spirit, was cast out of them. And then I believe that if that occurs and that there is an actual possession of that person, I don't believe that person is saved and is a Christian. But I believe when you commit your whole life to Christ, you ask Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, and you're not just mouthing words, okay, but you surrender your heart to Jesus Christ, okay, and you surrender to him, and he comes into you, which the Bible promises that he would do. When he went to the cross, he said he would send his Holy Spirit to dwell in us, okay, as opposed to just being around us and sometimes settling on us and then leaving. But his Spirit would dwell within us, okay. At that point, I don't believe in any means, by any means, that a Christian can be possessed. But I have seen born-again, professed, born-again, and true Christians, and I'm one of them, okay, that have been oppressed and harassed by demonic spirits, okay, to the point where we would have to bind it. And then we'd have to say, well, I cast this spirit out of this room, or I cast it out of this house, or I cast it out from harassing me and following me and various different things, because these things do happen, all right? So I want to kind of lay that as my foundation, and I want to encourage those that are listening tonight to do me the favor, okay, of going back maybe 4 or 5 posts on my Facebook Live if you have Facebook Live, because this is also being put onto YouTube. But on Facebook Live, if you're listening, or if you're on YouTube, go to my Facebook, because I put this on public, not on private or friends only. Okay, and go back and look at the four posts back and where I get into part one, because we're going to do our study. I don't always just preach, and I don't always just do it strictly from the Word of God. There are times that I find articles or things of interest that I know are the Word of God, and I want to share them with you. And I think one of the most competent and reliable experts in the area of exorcism, in the area of demons and demon spirits, is none other than the late Dr. Lester Sumrall. Okay, and I have one of his books, and I had read this book a couple of times, and passed it over to a couple of other pastors also who really enjoyed it. And the book is titled Lester Sumrall. That's Lester, in case you want to get it on eBay or on Amazon.com. You could probably find it there used. Lester Sumrall, Sumrall. The title of the book is Exorcism, The Reality of Evil and Your Power Over It. And this is just a super powerful book, and it deals with a whole lot of different things, okay? Diana, God bless you. I see that you're coming on. If you didn't get the beginning of this, you really need to go back to the beginning to hear what I've said up to this point. And I say that to everybody else that's signing on now. And do me the big favor, if you didn't hear part one, go back about four posts so you can listen to part one. Okay, because it will help you in as we continue forward. Okay, I don't want to have to repeat everything I just said in the last 5 or 10 minutes, so I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go ahead and move on into this. I've already answered a short answer in short up about possession and harassment, the difference between possession and between oppression. When people say pray over another Christian, say we cast out the spirit of lust, or we cast out the spirit of anger, we cast out the spirit of death, one would infer from those words that a Christian is being possessed by these spirits, okay? And really what they're doing, it's not true. When the Holy Spirit resides in you, there's no way a demonic spirit can coexist in the same place with the Holy Spirit. So you have to ask yourself, number one, if a professed or supposed Christian is actually really possessed, okay, you have to ask yourself, is he really a Christian? And the answer is no. Okay, if he doesn't have the Holy Spirit dwelling within him, then he's not. And if he had the Holy Spirit dwelling within him, he couldn't be possessed. Okay, so the second question is, well, then what happens if a person goes to church, they sing in the choir, they do all these different things, and they seem to be Christians, but, you know, there are so many in our society today that claim to be. They profess to be Christians, but they haven't surrendered and really given their heart to the Lord. Okay, and so those people are open to possession. Okay, because that the there is a void that's there that hasn't been filled by anything, and so either the Lord can come and fill that in, or Satan can come and take hold of it. And believe me, there are a lot of religious people that are religious, okay, that don't have a true relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, that are, in fact, open to possession, okay? But then we have to ask ourselves, who is a Christian, okay? And I just kind of elaborated on that. But the second thing is that many people jumble the words around. We cast the spirit of so-and-so out. We cast the spirit of this out and the spirit of that out. And somebody standing back and just kind of, watching it, and they know that this person is a Christian, say, you know, this can't be right. We see it, as I said, in the Word of Faith movements a lot, in the charismatic movements a lot. How can they be casting a spirit of death or a spirit of lust or a spirit of anger? How can these spirits actually possess a person? You know, a Christian too, a spirit-filled Christian. And the answer is it can't. But, okay, the people that pray that way are making a mistake, and they're saying we cast the spirit out of the person, not understanding that the person is not possessed, they are oppressed. Okay, can a Christian be oppressed by a spirit of lust, a spirit of death, a spirit of anger, and many of the other types of spirits that are out there? Absolutely. A Christian, a born-again, spirit-filled holy, God-fearing, God-loving, cross-believing Christian absolutely can be oppressed, because Satan will come many times, and if we somehow, because we're not perfect as Christians, as we somehow open the door to that, maybe through fear or other things, then we open up the door for the enemy to come in and oppress us, which means he's not dwelling in us, but he's harassing from the outside, okay? So can a Christian be hurt by a demonic spirit? The answer is absolutely he can, if he allows it, okay? But it's, or she allows it. But we have authority over those things. That's why we have to pray. And I have been oppressed by demonic spirits, out of ministry and in ministry, to the point where I have had to turn and I've had to bind them and cast them out. We first bind the strong man, then we plunder his house. But we take authority over these things. We say, Lord, I cast this spirit of fear, or this spirit of illness or sickness or infirmity out of this house in Jesus' name. It's not in me. It's oppressing me from the outside. So I have to cast it out of my house or out of my room, or maybe it follows me around like a little brown dog in the morning when I wake up, and at night when I go to bed, and when I get up in the morning, there it is. You know, those are spirits of oppression. I've seen it attack the mind of believers sometimes, and they think that they're going insane. They're having panic attacks, anxiety attacks, other things like that. Are they possessed? No. Are they crazy? No. But there is an oppression, a spirit that is coming in and that is oppressing them, and it has to be bound, and that's how we deal with it, okay? So I want to make that clarification again, and then I want us to move forward, and we're going to part two, and I don't know how many parts this is going to be. We had part one, and if you go down about four posts here on my Facebook Live, again, if you're on YouTube, go to my Facebook Live. I open these teachings up for the public, so go down and about four or five posts, and you should see it won't say part one, but it'll simply say, can a Christian be possessed or hurt by a demon? Okay, and that was actually part one, and now we're into part two. We'll probably do three or four parts of this, and as I said right before some of you signed on, I think one of the great authorities on this is Dr. Lester Sumrall. He has probably written the most extensively on demonic spirits, and has a great understanding of it and everything. And so I'm going to teach and read from his book, Lester Sumrall. The book is called Exorcism. I know you're seeing it backwards probably because I'm doing this on, with the camera reversed a little bit. But it says Exorcism, The Reality of Evil and Your Power Over It. Now, I'm sure that you could get this book if you go on to eBay or if you go to Amazon.com. I believe that it can still be found, and it's certainly worth it. It's the best book in dealing with demonic activity and demonic spirits that I've read. And so here we're going to take off and we're going to continue. So let me just open up, and before I go further, let me stop and just say a word of prayer here before we go further. Father, I thank you so much, Lord, for the opportunity to minister and teach your word tonight, Lord. It doesn't always have to come just directly from me, or Lord, but Lord, sometimes you supplement things in your word, and you bring knowledge and understanding of your word, of the Bible, through the mouths and through the writing, the pen, and the ink of others. And so, Father, we look to expand our knowledge, Lord, on demon activity and how we would relate to that, Lord, by the power of your word tonight. And we ask, Father, that your word be brought forth, and that those that are listening receive it, and that it bears fruit within their hearts. In Jesus' name, and I thank you for it. Amen. All right. So if you have this book, we're on page 140. And I'll stop and make some comments. You've already heard quite a bit of what I have to say on the subject, okay? But we're going to start on page 140, and we're going to subcaption. This subcaption, okay, is going to be, is possession by evil spirits constant or sporadic? In other words, is it continual, or does it come and go? Okay, just so you know, okay, what you missed, if you didn't watch part one, We spoke about, can a godly believer be possessed by demons? We spoke about, isn't it dangerous to talk about Satan? We answered those questions. Can a Christian be cursed by demons? Can a demon-possessed person be freed against their will? Against their will. We talked about that. Okay, so now here we're going to talk about, how is possession by evil spirits constant or sporadic? So I'm going to read, okay, from this, and I'll make comments wherever I think they're appropriate. Also, I want to watch the clock. Okay, so it's I have it 8:15 now, so I want to wrap this up usually by about 8:30. So we got about 15 minutes, you know, if at the most I go 8:40 or so, but we'll just see kind of how the Lord leads us in this. Okay, so I'm going to read, and I'll interject whatever commentary I have, if I have any. But I want you to pay attention and to listen, okay? Okay, so is possession by evil spirits constant or sporadic? Okay, when a person is possessed, the manifestation that possesses can be sporadic, okay? The possession itself is constant, okay? The manifestation, though, of that possession can be sporadic. In other words, what's being said here is that when a person is possessed by a demonic spirit, that demonic spirit is in them, okay, constantly, okay? But it may only manifest itself sporadically. You mean, in other words, every second of the day, 24/7, that a person is demon-possessed, that demon is not manifesting necessarily, okay? It may manifest at different times. It could be once a day. It could be once a week. It could be once a month. It could be once a year. It could be every couple years or something. It varies, okay? And so we're going to get into that. So when a person is possessed, the manifestation, understand that, the manifestation, the appearance, the outward showing of that possession, okay, can be sporadic. The possession itself is constant and continuing, although there may not be any evidence of it all the time. That's what I just said. The spirit possessing a person can manifest itself at different times. For example, he had spoken about this in his book, so you'll have to read this. He refers to a witch doctor from Brazil, and he goes back and makes the point here. For example, the witch doctor from Brazil had some spirits in him which only manifested themselves once a year. Other people may have demonic spirits that manifest themselves every day. Okay? The demoniac of Gadara had become an uncontrollable wild man, living in a cemetery and cutting himself with stones. When Jesus came, the demoniac screamed, I know you. Have you come to torment me before my time? But the possessed man in the synagogue was comfortable. Now he's talking about another person, a possessed man. There was a man that had been attending a synagogue or so. But the possessed man in the synagogue was comfortable at church among other people, yet both were possessed by demons. So what is that saying? There could be a person that's out in the world that's just wild, running crazy. He's totally demon-possessed, but we can also see it in the church. But that doesn't necessarily mean that that person in the church or in the synagogue is a Christian. Okay, there are religious people, and they're really not Christians. So again, it comes back to having to identify, well, who really is a Christian, or what really is a Christian? Okay, so you have to know that, and you have to answer that question when you're dealing with this issue. Okay, so how many demons, subcaption, okay, can one person have? That's the next question. How many demons can one person have? Okay, I'll read. It can vary from one to thousands. Many people in the Bible were plagued with only one demon spirit. In Mark 9:25, we read, when Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him, and enter no more into him. This person was possessed by one spirit that manifested in two ways, deafness and dumbness. Okay, in Luke 11:26, we read, of a person with 8 evil spirits living in him. Quote, then goeth he and taketh to him 7 other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. Now, see, that's important because when you cast a spirit out of a person that's demonically possessed, especially when you're dealing with, of course, when you're dealing with somebody in the world, or like I say, a person that's not a Christian can't be possessed. So you cast a spirit out of somebody, folks, it's you can't just leave it there, okay? Because that spirit will seek to return with 7 others worse than himself, and the state of that person will be worse than what it was when you first laid hands on him and cast the spirit out. So it has to be filled. That person has to be, the void has to be filled with Christ, okay? So if you're going to deliver somebody and cast the spirit out of somebody, make sure that they make a commitment, a true surrender to the Lord, because that spirit will seek to return. And if the house is vacant, empty, there is nothing there, the Holy Spirit is not there, it will come back and re-enter that person with 7 spirits worse than it was before. And I have seen that happen to people, okay? So I'm telling you, it's real. And so we want to make sure that we understand the necessity of filling the void. So when you, if you're going to pray over somebody and you're going to cast the spirit out, don't just do that and say, okay, well, he's delivered, praise God, bless God. And if the person gives some type of mental assent, okay, you know, I'm glad I'm delivered, yes, I believe in Jesus. But folks, okay, that's not enough, okay? Believing is not enough. They need to invite him into their heart. They need to surrender into their heart. It has to be a real thing, okay, or the enemy will try to come back and will succeed, all right? So we want to make sure we understand that. So how many people can possess, or how many demons can possess a person? Well, we also read that the demoniac of Gadara was controlled by a legion. A legion is 1,000, okay? He was so controlled by a legion, at least 1,000 demons, Luke 8:30. Okay, you can read it there. Okay, so now we want to talk about the next subcaption. I'm moving kind of fast, but I know you'll get this, and if not, you can come back and watch it again. Okay, can demons be inherited? Now, that's an interesting question. Can a demon be inherited? So can it move from one person to another person, maybe from one family member to another family member, or from or something like that? Can it be inherited? Okay, yes. And this is Lester Sumrall speaking. Yes. He says, in Java, I met a man who had 7 spirits that manifested through him. He had willed. Okay, note the what I'm saying. He had willed, W-I-L-L-E-D. He had willed these spirits to his teenage son. The lad was, now here's the kick. The lad was happy to receive these evil spirits and was eager for them to come into him at his father's death. Now, that's very interesting. So, can they be inherited? Yes. If the person that is receiving the inheritance willfully wants to accept it, okay, or is void, okay, of Christ, then certainly that spirit can be passed on, and you know, to another individual, okay? Can a person be possessed and not know it? I think that's a good question, because I think sometimes people wonder. When you go back, I go back and think about my life. I had a demonic oppression that was so real that at one point, and I'm going way back, when I was a young man in the military at one point, and some brethren laid their hands on me, and I actually physically felt something right from, I kid you not, it went right from my legs out through my body and up through the top of my head, and it was out. And I thought for sure I was possessed. But I thought, how could I be possessed? I'd asked the Lord into my heart, I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit. You know, I speak with other tongues. How could that be? But I asked the minister that he and a group of other brothers had prayed over me in a home study. And I asked him, was I possessed? Because my whole body and appearance and everything just changed after that incident. He says, no. He says, you weren't possessed, but you were oppressed by a psychic spirit. Okay, and so, but the oppression sometimes can be so real, you can almost feel or think that it's possession. Okay, so can a person be possessed and not know it? Yes, many people have demonic problems that they do not recognize. Usually these people realize that they have a problem but do not understand exactly what it is. Okay, often they do not believe in the reality of demons. This is one of Satan's greatest deceptions. An example of a time when the disciples were under the influence of spirits that they did not recognize is found in Luke 9:55. Okay, Jesus turned and rebuked them, saying, you know not what manner of spirit you're of. Okay, so, and then he goes on, and I'm going to come back and talk about this in a minute. In Matthew 16:23, Jesus declares that Satan is working as an alien influence through Peter without the apostles' knowledge. Jesus turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of a man. So, you know, now we're not talking about a Christian per se in the sense that we would talk about now, because at that time, folks, when Jesus was walking the earth, the disciple, okay, Christ, number one, he hadn't died for their sins, so the Holy Spirit was not continually dwelling within them. That didn't happen until the book of Acts, okay? So there was a, even though they were followers of Jesus, okay, the enemy was able to come and to go and able to enter in just as much as the Holy Spirit could rest upon a person, the devil could rest upon a person. So sometimes, and that's why the Lord spoke to Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan. Did Satan come in and possess Peter? I'm not sure. Okay, I think that it could have been that if we take that and break it down, look at it in the Greek, that the spirit was simply influencing Peter, was so much behind him that it had almost become a part of him. And the same for the situation of the disciples. But the most important thing to remember is that it would not apply now, because at that time, no one had the Holy Spirit dwelling within them except Christ himself. You know, when the Spirit had descended and settled upon him like a dove. Okay, but no one had the Spirit. None of the disciples, even though they walked with Jesus Christ, they were not filled with the Spirit of Christ, because he had not died yet. He had not resurrected yet, and the Holy Spirit had not come yet. Remember that the coming of the Holy Spirit occurred after Christ's crucifixion and his resurrection. That is why in the Gospels, the Word of God tells us that Jesus says to his disciples, it's expedient that I go, you know, I go to the cross and so forth and so on, and that that these things take place so that the Holy Spirit that would come, a teacher would come and will guide you in to things of righteousness and conviction of sin and so forth and so on, that it would dwell, the Spirit of God would dwell within them, okay? And we know that happened. We saw it in Acts chapter 2, okay? So I want to make sure we kind of talk about that. And then the next question is, can animals be possessed? Well, I can answer that one. You know, absolutely they can. You know, I've seen it. I've seen demon-possessed dogs myself, where I've rebuked the spirit of Satan in that animal, and the spirit left. But we'll see what Lester Summerall has to say about it. Can animals be possessed? His answer, yes. The classic example is Satan's entering the serpent in Genesis 3:1. That's a good point. Okay, in the new, you know, we know that Satan did enter into the serpent. Read it in Genesis 3:1. Okay, and in the New Testament, we read of spirits entering swine or entering the pigs. Remember that story? Okay, where all these spirits were cast out of, I believe, the man from Gadara who ran in the caves and everything, and the spirits were cast out, and they begged Jesus to go into the swine they went into the swine, so they were actually these herds of animals, these swine, these pigs were possessed, and they went right off a cliff into the water, you know. So we see in the New Testament that spirits did enter the pigs in Luke 8:33. That's okay. So he goes on to say, today we have many examples of dogs, I've seen that, horses, and other animals suddenly going mad. Okay, often they injure themselves or people, even sometimes becoming man killers, and they must be destroyed. Okay, this sudden rush of violence suggests the presence of a demonic spirit, man. And when I hear that, it just makes me think sometimes of the personality changes of people that are not Christians. Okay, but how can a person that seems so nice and so good and has generally good qualities all of a sudden turn into this type of vicious person? Well, you know, sometimes, Lord, sometimes it's not in the mind. Sometimes there's something deep taking place, especially when we look at the crimes and the things that we see in our society today. And I think so many of us are looking at the person. He's a racist, or he's this, he's a nut, he's that. You know, we think of different things and why people do things, and we don't understand that what the Bible says, that we war not against flesh and blood, okay, but unseen principalities and powers, spirits of wickedness in high places, rulers of darkness. Okay, so what are we saying here? I'm saying that many of these things, we want to put a label on somebody, whether it's their color or whether it's a mental issue or something else. He's crazy. No, he's a racist. No, he's white. No, he's black. This is the kind of stuff that's going on in our society today. Folks, the people that are doing all the talking, okay, on your news media and everywhere else, they have no knowledge of the spirit realm. Okay, those of us that are Christians ought to know that many of these, if you want to call them qualities, I wouldn't call them qualities, many of these, manifestations, okay, they're demonic. They come from possession of a demon spirit. And so we need to understand where our battle really is, okay? It is not against somebody else's flesh and blood. Okay, I could get really specific here, you know, but I'm not going to, because there are some people and there are some events and some things going on, and I don't know that person, okay? So I can't speak specifically to it. But I can say that many of the things that people do and the ways they act are demonic. I believe there are spirits of racism that exist. I do. I believe there are spirits of insanity and things like that. And I believe people that are not Christians, that do not have the Holy Spirit in them, that have that void that we talked about right here, absolutely can be possessed by those spirits. And they may not manifest themselves 24/7, every minute of the day. They may show up at different times, or they could be there showing themselves all the time. Okay, so anyway, let's continue. So anyway, he goes on to suggest that to say that animals could be possessed, and he talks about the serpent, how the serpent, Satan entered the serpent, and he talks about how spirits entered the swine in the New Testament, which we remember and we heard about. Okay, and we have many examples of that type of thing. Okay, now the other subcaption, I'm keeping my eye on the time, so we're about 30 minutes now. I'm going to go probably another 5 minutes and we'll pick it up. It looks like we're going to be doing a part three to this. Let me take a peek. Yeah, we got a lot to cover. Okay, so here's another subcaption. Are there always physical manifestations when evil spirits leave? When an evil spirit leaves somebody, is there always a manifestation? Is there a way to actually tell by looking physically that this person was possessed and now they're unpossessed? Okay, the spirit has left them. And Lester Summerall's comments are this way. He answers the question, not always. There's not always a physical manifestation when evil spirits leave. Not always. Luke 8:2 doesn't mention any manifestation during Mary Magdalene's deliverance from seven demons, nor does Luke 7:21. But in Mark 9:26, the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, And he was as one dead, inasmuch as that many said, he is dead. So in several instances, there was no visible manifestation of the demonic spirit leaving the person. And yet, in this last situation, Jesus prays for a man and casts out a demon spirit, and he thrashes it around, and then he falls and, you know, looks like he's dead. There was an absolute manifestation when that spirit left. Okay, so, but the answer, are there always physical manifestations when evil spirits leave? The answer is no. Okay, subcaption, can a house be possessed by demons? Well, I know the answer to that, okay, because I've seen it many, many times. I've walked into homes. Not only have I felt a spirit of oppression, but there, in my opinion, were possessions. And many times, folks, that can be through articles and things that are in the home. But I think that it's very close to oppression and possession in this particular situation. Anyway, let's see what Lester Sumrall has to say. Dr. Sumrall, can a house be possessed by demons? Yes, evil spirits prefer human beings, but they will often live in buildings. Well, that's true then. When we're talking about that type of possession, see, we're talking about, can, you know, we see these Ghostbusters, not the comedy boat Ghostbusters, but you can watch on television, people going in and taping and trying to exorcise spirits or watch spirits or film spirits in houses that are haunted, things like that. They think it's somebody that used to live there or whatever, but folks, I mean, there are demon spirits, and they're looking to take possession, and many times they'll dwell in a place. So he goes on to say, yes, evil spirits prefer human beings, but they will often live in buildings. I've seen this phenomena in pagan temples around the world. I have also seen it in private dwellings. Often these are houses in which a violent crime or some occult practice has taken place. I mean, it's interesting. Are there religious spirits? So, you know, I believe that there are. Lester Sumrall says yes. They are often the most difficult with which to deal. 1 John 4, 1 through 3 warns us that many spirits will work in the area of false religion. Here he quotes it, "Beloved, believe not every spirit." Okay, but try the spirits, whether they are of God. Okay, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof you have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. Okay? Paul confirms this in this revelation in 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 3. I'm quoting him now, okay? Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart the faith, giving heed to what? Seducing spirits and doctrines of demons or doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them that believe and know the truth. False religious spirits will become more active as we near the end of the present age. I believe that. I think we're seeing that in our society today, more than ever now. Boy, you know, the Bible says in the last days men would call good evil and evil good. And we're seeing that taking place. And it says that they will hold to a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. All these things are happening in the rapidity, or it's like birth pangs, as the Bible describes. They become more intense and faster over time as they begin to manifest itself. And we're just seeing it. We're seeing it in government. We're seeing it in judicial things. We're seeing it everywhere. It's really, really, if you weren't a Christian and did not know the Bible and know the book and know the end, it would really be frightening. And for the people that don't know the Lord, it is frightening. The Bible says in the last days, men's hearts will fail them for fear. I can see why. Amen. So we go on to say, he goes on to say, he goes on, forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath, I'm sorry, let me back up. Okay, he goes on saying, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath created to be received, okay, with thanksgiving of them that believe and know the truth. Amen. False religious spirits, again, I'm continuing the reading. False religious spirits will become more active as we near the end of the present age. Quote, okay, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect, proclaims Matthew 24:24. In these last days in which we live, there's going to be an acceleration of demon power in religion. We see this in our country now, in the gurus who have come here from India. They say they have come to teach Americans how to have peace, how to have a mind that is comforted. They are deceiving many. I recently visited a Buddhist temple in downtown San Francisco, close to Chinatown. One whole wall in the temple was solid gold. And as I looked through this gorgeous temple worth millions of dollars, I looked into a lavish and beautiful theater area. All the seats were plush. Some 300 people were taking lessons in Buddhism. Every one of these people were Americans. The final struggle of the ages has already begun on the face of the earth today. The final victory that we have just been reading about is apparent. The greatest masterpiece of this struggle will be religious in nature. The false prophet will stand beside the Antichrist. And all the Bible says that he will, I'm sorry, and the Bible tells us, okay, that he will bring fire down from heaven in the sight of men. He will cause that idol to speak like a man speaks. All the world will say, who is like him? The greatest deception will be religious deception. Absolutely true. Those of us with spiritual discernment well understand these things when they start to happen. And I think that's amazing. I see that. A lot of the world, they're worried. They're shaking their, they don't understand. They don't. Matter of fact, people that I've known for years, okay, it's like they've gone insane. I look on social media, I read their posts, we'll get their points of view over things, and I thought, is this the person that I knew, you know, back in 1983 or 87? It's just almost unbelievable, because they're not Christians, they're not filled with the Spirit of God, and yet I look at those that are filled with the Holy Spirit, and they know what's going on. They see it, they understand it, they discern it, okay? And that's why when the Bible talks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't, some people say, I have the gift of discernment. No, folks, there is no gift of discernment. There is a gift of discerning of spirits, okay? And right now, we need the gift of discerning of spirits so that we can understand what's going on in the world, okay? And so, I just want to make that point, apart from what Dr. Summerall said. So anyway, he goes on to say that the greatest deception will be a religious deception. Those of us with spiritual discernment will understand these things when they start to happen. Okay, now, he goes on to say, but we must have more and more spiritual discernment in all of our churches today. Otherwise, the things that are about to take place in this last generation, quote, shall deceive the very elect, close quote. That is why I have been moved by the Holy Spirit of God to write this book, quote, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God. And he quotes Acts 26:18 as referencing that comment. Okay? To show unto his servants things that must shortly come to pass. Revelation 1:1. Okay, and am I going to take any more? I've gone 45 minutes. Okay, so The next question will be, our subtitle will be, how many evil spirits are there? And then we'll cover, are demons more active in some nations than others? What happens to a demon when it when someone it possesses dies? Where do demons that aren't in humans go? Do demons believe in God? What did Jesus himself say about demons? Is some of this just a return to old superstitions? Let's see what else we're going to be covering. Quite a few subtitles still left, okay? Do we favor book burning? Is hypnotism demonic? What's wrong with exhibiting idols? And let's see what else we have. Are demons responsible for everything bad in the world? Is a nervous breakdown a sign of demon possession? Let's see. Is schizophrenia caused by demonic possession? Have any famous people in history been possessed? Are some demons worse than others? What technique should we use to exorcise demons to get rid of them? These are things that we'll talk about, and that will probably conclude this particular subject, but we've got quite a few more subcaptions. We might be able to cover all of that in part 3. And in the most, I can't see this as going more than 4 parts, but it will be part 3 probably. And so I'll be back again on Tuesday at 8 p.m. Next time. Sorry again for Wednesday coming in today, but I was not able to get back from an out-of-town situation last night in time to do this. But we're always doing it on Tuesday night at 8 p.m. So folks, if you enjoyed this, I encourage you to get the book by Dr. Lester Sumrall, Exorcism. Go on to eBay or go on to Amazon. He's the late Dr. Sumrall was probably one of the most foremost authorities accurately and scripturally on demonic activities. And he wrote the book again. I'm going to show it to you, Exorcism, The Reality of Evil and Your Power Over It. So it deals with so many things, so many subjects regarding the area of the demonic. Not that we have an infatuation, and I want you to understand, okay, by giving these lessons, okay, I'm not suggesting that we have an infatuation with demonic power, but folks, you got to know who you're fighting. You have to know your enemy and understand how he works, and so it's very good to read this stuff. Now, I see some people that seem to be obsessed by demons and the powers of darkness and things like that, so much so, and it can be the same thing too with people that are possessed, so, or I should not possessed, but obsessed with the end time prophecy and the events, and they get into a tangent on these particular issues, okay, and they get their focus off the Lord. We don't want that. You keep your focus on Christ, what he did on the cross, his victory in your life through the shedding of his blood and our faith in that provision on the cross. We need to stay in tune with the most important aspects of the basics of the gospel, but at the same time we need to understand some of these other things also, okay, because they're included in the gospel message, all right? So that's why we're covering that this evening. All right, so again, I'm ready to close, and folks, if you enjoyed this, hit the like button, let me know that you did, and a lot of people listen, I see like 4 or 5 likes sometimes on these broadcasts, but then when I look and see how many people have watched, I see 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, or more people from all over the world watch these broadcasts, so I'm appreciative of that, and one of the things that you can do that will bless this ministry in doing these type of broadcasts is hit your share button, folks. It takes a second to do it. Just write, type, listen to this, share, okay? And there will be some people that will be hungry for the Lord that will listen, and this may provide a lot of insight and answers to them, and it's a way of getting the Word of God out to everybody, because all of you have friends on your friend list that I don't have, and so I may never be able to minister to them in person. But you can help me do that by sharing the message with others. Okay, so, all right, I want to say God bless you. This is Apostle Misha Softier saying good night. Keep the faith, and let's get back together Tuesday night, 8 p.m. All right, God bless you, and have a nice evening. Bye-bye.